Okay, so thanks a lot. Thanks to the organizers. So let's see. So yeah, so I'm going to be talking about hyperbolic groups. And so this is divided into three moderately self-contained lectures. So the first one will be motivation, definition, and the main mathematical theme will be robustness of the definition or stability. Bigger? Okay. Second point, it's okay? No, I'm serious. I'm not joking. This size is okay? Yeah. Okay. So the second thing will be about equivalent notions of hyperbolicity. So this is lecture. This is the first one. This is the second one. And the last thing will be about boundaries. Okay. So So let's start with the first lecture, and I'll keep on indicating where things that we describe during these lectures is going to be used by various speakers next week and the week after that. Okay, so let's start with motivation. So the theory of hyperbolic groups is motivated by two sets of examples. Example one, these are fundamental groups of closed, negatively curved manifolds. So, for instance, I mean, Harish, towards the last part of his talk, introduced hyperbolic N space. So, e.g., let gamma act on Hn by isometries properly discontinuously and co-compactly. What all this stuff means is essentially it makes sense to pass this M. This is a closed manifold. Properly, discontinuously, and let's say freely. So there are no fixed points. So this means that pi 1 M, this is gamma, this is the fundamental group, and this is an example of a hyperbolic group. This is one set of examples. The second set of examples is not so easy to define. I'll just mention the words. This comes from what used to be called combinatorial group theory. These are what are called small cancellation groups. Part of differential geometry, so where you have you need calculus to define negative curvature at a point. And what you are requiring in the first case is that at every point, along every two-dimensional plane, the curvature is bounded above by some negative number, some fixed negative number. The second set of examples comes from treating completely the opposite end of the spectrum, discrete groups, where groups are described in terms of generators and relations. And this small cancellation is the thing that you should carry in mind is that two relations, these are like disks that you glue in to build up your group, these have small overlap. Yeah? These are just some words, but the take home is that it's a very combinatorial condition, very discrete kind of condition. And these two things were unified by Gromov, 1982 to 87, approximately in somewhere in that period, in a bunch of papers, to give the theory of hyperbolic groups. All right. Before I come to the definition of what hyperbolic groups are, we'd like to get the context straight. What are the objects that we are studying? What are the morphisms between them? So, objects are X, D, these are geodesic metric spaces. What does that mean? First, that XD is a metric space for all PQ belonging X. There exists an isometric embedding F from 0 to this, from this to X, such that F of 0 equal to P, F of distance PQ equal to Q. So what does that mean? For all PQ, there exists geodesic between them. So this is how you refer to this. Or any two points in the space can be joined by a geodesic. Yeah? And this is one of the reasons why I was trying to get Harish to mention completeness in towards the end of his talk. What are examples of this? So from the differential geometric point of view, so example, complete Riemannian manifolds. Well, let's just put this word here. Geodesically complete Riemannian manifolds. What does that mean? Any two points. So you have a Riemannian manifold. Any two points can be joined by a distance minimizing geodesic. That's equivalent to a certain, I mean, any Riemannian metric gives rise to a metric in the usual sense of a metric space. You look at paths between pairs of points, look at the infimum of all those distances. That's going to give you a metric on your manifold, on any Riemannian manifold, not necessarily geodesically complete. And if you demand that the metric that you get in the process is complete in the sense that Cauchy sequences converge, such a manifold is called metrically complete or just complete. Yeah. So there's this famous theorem of Hopf-Prino which says that geodesic completeness and metric completeness are equivalent. I think Harish is going to mention that in his next talk. So that's one class of example. This is from the first very smooth, continuous, infinitesimal site. Proper metric space. Yeah, so for proper metric spaces, these two are equivalent. Correct. Your correct statement, yeah. Okay, so first thing is, these are, so geodesically complete Riemannian manifolds are one set of examples. Second set of examples, and this is really what's going to motivate, I mean, this is going to be another ingredient that feeds into this. Graphs with edge length 1. Okay. So just connected graphs. Yeah. So you take just any arbitrary graph, which means just a collection of vertices, collection of edges, and declare that all the edges have length 1. So then what is the metric on it? Take any vertex, take any other vertex, look at an edge path from the first vertex to the last vertex, and you look at the number of edges. So it's a very, this is from the differential geometric point of view, this is from the combinatorial point of view. Yeah? So you look at edge paths from a vertex to another vertex and look at the minimum length. So now you're not taking an infimum, you're just taking a minimum because all the lengths are integral. Yeah? So now we are not going to be interested in arbitrary graphs, though we could really. So from the notion of, I mean, from these graphs, we'll get a. So 2A, these are special graphs. So these are called Cayley graphs of finitely generated groups. So from an algebraic gadget, namely a finitely generated group, we are going to manufacture a graph and hence a geometric object, namely a geodesic metric space. So let's see. So G is a finitely generated group, G1 through Gn, and then you have a bunch of relations. What this means is you take the free group on the n generators G1 through Gn, and you quotient out by the normal subgroup generated by R1 through R2, et cetera, et cetera. This need not be a finite set. The set of relations need not be a finite set. Okay, so let's call this generating set R, the relation set, the generating set S and the relation set R, gamma G R. This is a graph. Vertex set consists of all the group elements, and edge set consists of pairs G, H such that G inverse H belongs to S, the generating set. So please note one thing, that the Cayley graph does not just depend on the group G, it depends also on the depends on the generating set S. Yeah. We'd like to have a notion, I mean, when we are trying to do geometry on these spaces, yeah, we'd really like to capture the geometry of G independent of the generating set. This is an arbitrary choice. The generating set is an arbitrary choice. So we want something that is robust enough, and this is really the robustness that's mentioned there. Need notions that are robust enough to be independent of the choice of S, the choice of the finite generating set S. So which means that we should be able to come up with a notion of equivalence, saying that you choose some finite generating set S, and you choose some other finite generating set S prime. You construct the two different Cayley graphs, gamma GS and gamma GS prime. Then there should be a natural map, the identity map at the vertex level set, that should be a natural morphism in this category, should be the identity morphism in this category. Yeah? So that brings us to notions of equivalence or morphisms in this category. So the objects are geodesic metric spaces, morphisms or equivalences. So this is really, yeah, so let's put the definition down. F from X D to Y rho is a quasi-isometric embedding if is a K epsilon quasi-isometric embedding if for all X1, X2 belonging to X, 1 by K D X1, X2 minus epsilon less than equal to D FX1, FX2 less than equal to K D. Oh, this is not D, this is a rho. K D X1, X2 plus epsilon. So, turns out that the right kind of morphisms that we are looking at, so forget this epsilon for the time being. If you just ignore this epsilon, this is the standard notion of a Bielefschitz map, yeah? What this is doing is it's allowing you discontinuities at scale epsilon, yeah? So finite balls of some radius, at most epsilon, these are allowed to be crushed to points, yeah? So there are some amount of discontinuity that you allow. Why is this a good notion for in this context? So first note that this really gives us an equivalence. Okay, so this is just a notion of a quasi-isometric embedding. One, two, F, again, from X to Y, is a quasi-isometry if A is a K epsilon C, is another constant. If A, F is a K epsilon, and I'll shorten this to QI, it's a QI embedding. B, F is C, coarsely surjective. What does that mean? I.e., Y is contained in the C neighborhood of Fx. So it's a coarsely surjective map. Coarsely just means that it's not surjective on the nose, but you look at the image, you take a ball around that, I mean, you take a neighborhood of that image, you're going to get everything. And I think I should mention the standard slogan in this area. It's basically if you want to use calculus, you'll have to have very good eyesight, right? You have to differentiate. You have to look at things which are very small, and you're going to have to manipulate, I mean, very small changes. What if your eyesight is bad? Yeah, I mean, in the sense that if you can't, so suppose flies were to do geometry, so then they would not be able to resolve between things which are very close. Yeah? So if you want to do geometry with bad eyesight, then the right framework is coarse geometry, where essentially you don't have, I mean, all finite sets. You fix a scale. This K epsilon and C is some kind of a fixed scale, which is going to be invariant for the discourse. And then you say that things which are within distance C from each other are indistinguishable. So then the right notion of a space and morphisms become this. And a notion of this of a quasi-isometry which is coarsely surjective, this turns out to be equivalent to the fact, which I shall not prove, that there exists G from Y to X which is a K prime epsilon prime QI embedding, such that F compose G and G compose F, so G C prime close to the identity for some C prime greater than zero. What does that mean? I.e., G compose F X X distance is less than equal to C prime. Similarly for F compose G. Yeah. So essentially a quasi-isometric embedding which is surjective automatically gives you an inverse. Yeah. And if you have an inverse, you already have this surjectivity. Yeah. So these are two equivalent notions, and these are the right morphisms in the category. Why are these appropriate? Yeah, so here's observation. S, S prime are, S1, S2 are finite generating sets of G. Assume S comma S prime are. This is going to be a standard assumption in our context. We assume, yeah? Oh boy. Yeah. So assume that these generating sets that we are talking about are symmetric, which means what? That means AI belongs to, or GI belongs to S1 if and only if GI inverse belongs to S1. Yeah? This is the same saying that S1 is symmetric, which means any element, if it's in the generating set, its inverse is also in the generating set. Why are we doing this? We want our graph to be an undirected graph. Yeah? So that's all. So basically going from a directed graph, in general, if you have a choice of a generating set which is not symmetric, you're going to get only a directed graph. We don't want that, so that's why we get into this. Yeah, E is outside. Yeah, E is outside S. If you put E, it's just going to clutter it up. So it's, yeah, you can put E also in the generating set. It's not really going to matter. Yeah, we'll see. We'll see that in a moment. So suppose you have two. I mean, yeah, I think the proper. Let's complete this observation. This question is going to get answered. Then gamma G S1 and gamma GS2 are quasi-isometric. And in fact, and the identity from G to G, so basically, let's IE from the vertex set of gamma S1, which is G, to the vertex set of gamma S2, which is again G. So the identity map on the vertex set is a quasi-isometry. So this, I mean, so once we've seen a proof of this, you'll see that it doesn't really matter if the identity is in there, because we are going to be discussing spaces only up to quasi-isometry. Okay, so what's the proof of this? First, so take H, so take S2 equal to H1 HM, S1 equal to G1 GN. So what does that mean? So each HI is a finite word of length LI in G1 to GN. So express each of these generators in terms of these generators, right? Each of these guys is going to give you some word. It has some length. Yeah? You don't need to be particularly efficient here. So you get some number. Yeah? So L is equal to max over I Li. Then that means what? So this implies that if DG, let's say 1W, is less than or equal to L DH 1W. So you look at any word, so W is below, W now, oh, this is not an H, what's this? This is D gamma S2. This is D gamma S1, yeah. So you look at, so you look at some arbitrary point, not equal, yeah, in the Cayley graph gamma with respect to S2. That's got some word describing that point, yeah? So each letter in this word is one of these HIs. You describe these HIs in terms of the generator's GIs, which means that each path of length 1, in each edge of length 1 in this path, what am I saying? So you have your 1 here, you have your W here, and you have an edge path between them. These guys, this belongs to S2. Yeah. So each of these guys belongs to S2. And each of these can be decomposed as a path of length less than or equal to L in the first, in the generating set of the first group. I mean, first presentation. So which means what? You're multiplying each of these guys at most by L. So the distance between 1 and W, you have a path of length at most L times the distance between 1 and W in the second guy. There's nothing special about S1 and S2. Similarly, there exists L prime such that D gamma S2 1W is less than or equal to L prime D gamma S1 1W. What are you going to do? You're going to do the reverse thing. You're going to express GI in terms of HI and you're going to get a new constant L prime. And so that means what? You've really got this constant here. I mean, just take K here. This K to be the maximum of L1 and L2, and you've got the quasi-isometry between them. So basically, at the vertex set level, there's a Bi-Lipschitz map. Yeah? So which means what? Which means that this notion of quasi-isometry seems to be the right kind of thing, because a priori you can have, yeah, there's a question. Oh, I see, I see. Well, you're saying whether this is a non-trivial theory or not, whether all graphs are going to be quasi-isometric? Yes, sure. So here, you take the real line, yeah? And take a point. They're never going to be quasi-isometric, right? So any infinite gadget and a finite gadget are never going to be quasi-isometric. There's much more than that, yeah? So I think that's part of what we're going to be talking about, yeah? This really captures a lot of, I mean, this is, I think, yeah. So why is it an, the question you're asking is, why is it an interesting theory? So that I think you'll have to wait to see, yeah? All right. So this is that. So basically, if we want a theory which is independent of the generating set, this seems to be a good notion. So here, I mean, it's a discrete space to a discrete space. So all maps are really continuous. So that epsilon really allows you discontinuities. Yeah, so it's not really visible here. So we'll come to that. And this is called the Milner-Schwartz lemma. I'll state it in terms of manifolds, but it's really much more general than this. So M, this is a complete Riemannian manifold. This is a complete Riemannian manifold. Gamma is a, it's a finitely generated group acting geometrically, I'll say what this means. On M. So what is geometrically, instead of saying all those words, free, properly discontinuous, bi-isometries, yeah, all that is abbreviated to saying geometrically. So this is equal to free plus properly discontinuous plus co-compact plus bi-isometric, bi plus isometric. So if you have a finitely generated group acting geometrically on this, then complete Riemannian manifold with metric G. Then MG is quasi-isometric to gamma. And when I now say quasi-isometric to gamma, I have ignored which finite generating set I choose. Yeah? Because we've already shown that it's independent of the finite choice of the generating set. Right? And to prove this, it addresses the issue that Manju raised. What's the point behind this? So let's take a very simple example. Yeah? Take R, take Z acting on R by N acting on little r is equal to R plus N. So the standard action of Z on R. This is an action by isometries, right? So this is our gamma. Yeah? So R mod gamma, this is S1. So S1 is compact. This action is free, properly discontinuous, co-compact by isometries. Yeah? What are we trying to say? So what does the Milner-Schwarz lemma say in this particular case? So MS lemma. This just says that R is quasi-isometric to Z. Yeah? This is what it says. More generally, as soon as you have a co-compact group action, it means that you lift, you take a point in the base manifold. So this, that means that the, given all this stuff, the quotient manifold M mod gamma, this is R mod gamma. So M mod gamma in general, this is compact. You pick a point in this compact manifold, lift it upstairs. Yeah? So you're going to, the lift is going to correspond to the orbit of a single lift by gamma, right? And so what you're going to do is, you think of a fundamental domain in this, in M, which means that you have a compact set whose translates cover the whole thing, yeah? What you're going to do is, you're going to take that compact set, each of these compact sets has one of these, at least one of these lifts of points. You're going to take that compact set and crush it down to that point. Yeah? There's some choice involved in this process. You might have finitely many points you can crush it to. And that's going to contribute to the discontinuity. Let's see this example here. So the nicest fundamental domain could be, say, minus half to half. Yeah? This seems to be the nicest thing to do. What this allows you to do is, you can forget about choosing nice fundamental domains. So suppose this is from minus half to half, and this from half to 3/2. So translates of minus half, half closed interval by Z covers all of R. Yeah? So now you look at this point, look at any point in the interior of this. What is your quasi-isometry going to do? It's going to take this whole thing and you're going to collapse it to zero. That's going to be your quasi-isometry map. Yeah? You have ambiguity exactly at these endpoints. You could collapse it to the left, or you could collapse it to the right. Yeah? That means this part, there's going to be a tearing. Right? How much is that tearing? It's going to, the discrepancy is going to be at most one. Yeah? So these epsilon could be in principle very large. Yeah? So it's not a very small number. It's one here. It could be 10,000, a million. It could be 10 power 23, anything. Yeah. So long as it's some finite number. Yeah. So you're allowed a finite amount of badness of eyesight, yeah, to do this. You have a freedom to change that metric. You do have a freedom to change that metric. I'll say what freedom you have. Basically, what it says, this is really looking at this whole picture in reverse. What you do is you start with a compact manifold. Yeah. So what's the compact manifold? S1 is your compact manifold. Choose an arbitrary metric on S1. Yeah? Arbitrary Riemann metric, not necessarily Riemannian metric, Finsler metric, whatever metric you like. Yeah. On S1. Lift that metric to the universal cover. Yeah? And then the metric on the universal cover, in this particular case, say R is your universal cover. The metric on the universal cover is going to be quasi-isometric to the fundamental group. Yeah? So what this Milner-Schwarz lemma says is essentially studying the universal cover of a compact gadget up to quasi-isometry is the same as studying the fundamental group up to quasi-isometry. Yeah. So maybe I'll mention a word about one side of the proof of this, because I think I have just half an hour and I have not yet started with the main point that I was supposed to be making. So let's try to see how. So what does this mean? So you have, okay, so this is R mod Z is one example. Let's draw this next example in a somewhat different way. So you have your word, so you have some finite generating set, right? So this is what we are going to give is a proof sketch of one of the sides of this lemma, which means, see, basically what do we want to prove? In order to prove quasi-isometry, we want to prove that the distance in the group is less than equal to some constant times distance in the manifold. We want to prove the other way. Distance in the manifold is less than equal to some constant times distance in the group plus some additive constant. So let's start off with this thing. You have, one more thing that I'm always choosing one as one of my base points. All the metrics that are there, they are invariant under the group action, right? So we can always choose an initial point to be the identity by left translating by some group element. Okay. So what do we have now? So W is equal to G1 dot dot GS. Let's see. R is also not a M N O. So what's going on? So you have one, then you have G1, then you have, and then you have, this is G1, this is G1, G2, this is G1, G2, G3, etc., etc. So now what do we have? G1 is one out of some finite set, right? So if it's some choice out of some finite set, it's going to move. This is 1 is equal to 1 dot acting on O. O is some base point. So G1 acts on O. The distance between G1 dot O, comma, 1 acting on O. This is less than equal to max little s acting on O, where S belongs to capital S, the generating set of gamma, right? So the distance between 1O and G1O, I'll give this a name, capital L. So this is less than equal to capital L. Again, G1 dot O, G1, G2 dot O. Again, this is invariant under the metric, so you can remove this G1. It's the distance between O and 2O. So this is also less than equal to L, right? So each of these guys is less than equal to L. So this gives the easy side of the Milner-Schwarz lemma. This means that you choose a geodesic in your Cayley graph. If it's of length n, this implies the distance between 1 and W acting on O is less than equal to length of W times some constant L. Yeah? So you've got one side of the Milner-Schwartz. The other side essentially is, it's a little more tricky, but it's not too hard. Okay, so this Milner-Schwartz really is the motivation for this epsilon. Allows you bounded amounts of discontinuity, which basically says that what's the upshot of all this? And this is really where the combinatorics and the differential geometry are coming together. So now let's give this. So the N is compact Riemannian. Pi 1 n is gamma. If n is a compact Riemannian manifold, it automatically gives you that gamma is not only finitely generated, it's finitely presented. Yeah? Which means that the generating set is certainly finite. The presentation, the number of relations you attach, that's also finite. Okay. So then this implies that, so this is Milner-Schwartz gives you that n tilde with the, so compact, so let's call this g. And g tilde is the pullback of the Riemannian metric upstairs. This is quasi-isometric to gamma with respect to any finite generating set. Okay. So which means that this basically says that up to quasi-isometry, if you realize your finitely presented group, it's a fact that any finitely presented group can be realized as the fundamental group of a closed smooth four-manifold. Yeah? So you take some closed smooth four-manifold, which realizes gamma as your fundamental group, put some arbitrary Riemannian metric there, lift everything to the universal cover, and then the universal cover of such four-manifolds and your original group are quasi-isometric, right? So basically, it says that these two things that we started off with, discrete groups on the one hand, Riemannian manifolds on the other, they can be put together on and given a unified treatment of, provided you are allowed to change the notions of objects to geodesic metric spaces and morphisms to quasi-isometries, okay? So this is the context of the problem. Okay. Now let's introduce negative curvature, and this is the notion of Gromov hyperbolicity. No, that C is a spurious C. So why is it a spurious C? We had said that there's a quasi-isometric inverse. I mean, if it's an equivalence of categories, right, of objects, then there should be an inverse, right? So the inverse is this K prime epsilon prime. So the inverse, there's a k prime epsilon prime quasi-isometry, right? Choose k to be maximum of k and k prime, epsilon to be maximum of epsilon and epsilon prime. So really that C is not there. It's absorbed in this k and epsilon. Yeah? So in the proof that there exists a quasi-isometric inverse, you are going to use that. So that's an equivalent notion. Yeah? I've not said very much about the proof. Okay, of that statement. Okay, so now let's define negative curvature in this coarse sense. So definition, X, D, geodesic metric space is delta hyperbolic if for all A, B, C belonging to X, A, B geodesic is contained in the delta neighborhood of the union of the subgroups. What does this mean? It just means that triangles A, B, C look like this. And then you can take a delta neighborhood so this distance is delta So look at these bananas or sausages, depending on whether you're vegetarian or non-vegetarian. And look at the delta neighborhood of these two things, and the union of these two contains the third side. Okay? So that's what it means. So basically, it means that all triangles have some thinness constant, delta. That delta can change. So, yeah. I sort of overstepped myself. I was about to say that XD is hyperbolic if it is delta hyperbolic for some delta greater than zero. So really, yeah. So basically, this says that all compact metric spaces, which means things which have bounded diameter, they are all quasi-isometric to points with some constant. Yeah? They're all delta hyperbolic for some delta. So what's important is hyperbolicity here, not the delta. That's what I meant to say. Yeah. So why is that important? And then we'll get to this. This is really the point of the talk today. Oh yeah, so this means that it's a geodesic. This notation means it's a geodesic between A and B. No uniqueness, nothing is there. For some geodesic. Yeah. You pick some geodesic and it happens. Yeah, so as a consequence, what will happen is that if you have a delta hyperbolic metric space, you have this definition. Yeah. Suppose there are two geodesics between the same pair of points. Yeah. From A to B, there's one geodesic. A to B, there's another geodesic. Right. Take the third side to be BB, that point. Yeah. Then one of these sides is going to be contained in the delta neighborhood of the other. Which means what? Which means if you have bad eyesight, the geodesic is unique. Yeah, it's coarsely unique. Yeah? So I'm trying to sort of stress this because it's a way of thinking that's there. So. You're not allowed to do infinitesimal computations. You're only allowed to sort of look at things in a... Hopefully by the end, we'll reinstate the infinitesimal thing at infinity. Hopefully. Okay, so this is a certain notion. And then this is just a... tentative definition. This is tentative. So gamma is a finitely generated group. Gamma is hyperbolic if gamma S is, okay. No, G is a finitely generated group. G is hyperbolic if gamma GS is hyperbolic for some finite generating set S. Okay, so the tentative definition is that you choose some generating set and you get that your Cayley graph is hyperbolic, yeah? And then you call the group hyperbolic. This is a bad definition. What if you change your generating set and don't get something to be hyperbolic? Well, this is a theorem. Theorem. This is due to Gromov. Basically says that hyperbolicity is a QI invariant. Which means what? If you have a space, I mean, so if you have a Cayley graph with respect to some finite generating set, Then with respect to some other finite generating set, the Killigrass are quasi-isometric. What Gromov's theorem here says is that you have a metric space, geodesic metric space, which is hyperbolic. You have another space which is actually just quasi-isometrically embedded in it is good enough. Then the new space is also hyperbolic. Yeah? That's what this says. Which means now you can really speak of a group, of a finitely generated group being hyperbolic. You don't have to regard what the finite generating set is, so long as you have some finite generating set. This is really the robustness stability that I was talking about. So the rest of the time, 15 minutes, we'll try to give a proof of this statement here. So let's draw this. So A, B, this is contained in your geodesic metric space XD. And suppose this is delta hyperbolic. Yeah, so you fix some delta, and assume that the space is delta hyperbolic for that delta. Now you have some path here. Yeah. Sigma from 0, 1 to x is a path, which means it's a continuous image of rectifiable path. Rectifiable or piecewise geodesic path of length L. Yeah? So this guy has length L. Claim, so this implies that if P belongs to L, then distance of P from the geodesic AB is less than equal to delta log base 2L plus 1. Basically, I mean, those constants are not important. Essentially says that if you have a path between these two points of length L, its distance from the geodesic joining them is logarithmic in length. Yeah? Equivalently, it says that if you take this geodesic, take say its endpoint, take say its midpoint, and you have a path going outside the ball of radius r about this point, then the length of this path has to be at least exponential in r. Yeah? So this is very different from what happens in Euclidean space. Yeah? You take centered at the origin, take a diameter, which is, radius r on each side. The semicircle has length pi times r. It's linear in this r. So in a delta hyperbolic metric space, if you travel far away from the geodesic, you're going to be exponentially inefficient. Yeah? That's what this says. Proof is quite simple. So what do you do? So forget P here. What are we going to do? So this is A equal to A naught, B equal to A sub n, where n is something like log sub 2 of L box. Yeah, something like that. So what are we going to do? You're going to take the midpoint. So this is our A n by 2 box. Yeah. Let's do that. Yeah, so if n is this is 2 power n, let's say. Yeah. So this is, yeah. Pardon me? Oh, can I write larger? Yeah, sorry. So, yeah. So you look at the, so this is A0, this is 2 power n. This is A 2 power n minus 1, it's the midpoint. Then you take the further midpoint, this is A 2 power A sub 2 power n minus 2. And this is, I think you should put this as, maybe I think this should be written as A 1 0 0 0. This is n times, yeah? And this is A sub 1000 is 10 minus 1 times. See, basically, what am I trying to say? You take this, A0000, and you want to do some kind of a binary division of this thing. So you take the midpoint here, and you draw this and draw this. So now this becomes a sub 2 power n minus 1. This guy is 2 power n. Yeah. Now this one is a sub 2 power n minus 2, and you draw this and you draw this. So in n steps, whichever interval. So for convenience of notation, let's go down to the first one. This is a sub 2 power n minus 3. So in order to get from, say, 2 power n minus 3 to a point, to this point. So from here, yeah. So from here, you're going to be able to go. Yeah, so this is going to be of length delta. From here, this is going to be of length delta. Less than equal to delta, less than equal to delta, less than equal to delta. So in n steps, you're going to reach this first one. So yeah. So what am I trying to say? We are saying that you look at the base geodesic. Yeah. To say P, no. I think I want to say the opposite thing. Yeah. So you start from here, start from the base point. This side is contained in the delta neighborhood of the union of the other two, right? So which means that this is going to be contained in the delta neighborhood of one of these guys. Choose this one. This one is going to be contained in the delta neighborhood of the union of the other two. Whichever one it is, it's going to be delta there. And you do this, how many times do you have to do it? You do it log of the length to the base 2 times, and then you're going to reach a path which is of length at most 1, right? By n subdivisions. So, which means you're going to come to an arc which is of length 1. From there, you can reach the boundary, that means the path here, in distance at most 1. So, I think I should have written here. This is not the right thing that I wanted to say. I wanted to say this. That's why there's a mistake here. Distance from P to sigma. P is any point on the geodesic. The estimation goes the other way. Take any point on the geodesic. It is within logarithm of the length of the path to the base 2 plus 1. So distance from P to sigma, call this P1, P2. And this guy is Pm. Oh, no, this is n. This is fine. This is distance between P and sigma. This is less than equal to distance P1 plus P1, P2 plus distance between Pn minus 1, Pn. And then from Pn, which is this point here, to the path, is plus 1. How many of these guys are there? That's log 2L, and each of these guys is less than or equal to delta. So this is less than or equal to n times delta plus 1, where n is the logarithm. Yeah. So this is the first stability result. Essentially says that if you travel outside, I mean, you have this arc there, to reach that, you from your geodesic, you need at most logarithm base 2. Worth of distance to go. So this is the first stability that we wanted. So now, the crucial thing that I want to prove, I mean, this is essentially something called the Mohr's lemma. Basically says that quasi-geodesics track geodesics. Which means what? Again. So A, B, So this path sigma, sigma is a K epsilon quasi-geodesic between A, B. And again, I mean, my standing hypothesis will be that the ambient space is a hyperbolic metric space. So this is in hyperbolic metric spaces. So you have a geodesic metric space, which is delta hyperbolic, and fix that delta. Now you have a quasi-geodesic between two points. The quasi-geodesic between these two points is going to lie close to a geodesic. Lies D close to AB, where D depends only on K, epsilon, and delta. Okay? So basically, if you're given your K and epsilon, the quasi-geodesic is going to lie within a bounded neighborhood of the geodesic with constant D, depending only on the badness of the quasi-geodesic and the delta of the metric space, the hyperbolic metric space. Oh, I didn't say what a quasi-geodesic is. Okay. Yeah. So a quasi-geodesic is a K epsilon, it's a quasi-isometric embedding of an interval. So K epsilon quasi-geodesic is a K epsilon QI embedding of an interval in the real line equipped with the Euclidean metric space, with the Euclidean metric. Yeah. Just take the standard R and then look at its image. We want to say that quasi-geodesics lie close to geodesics. Before getting into the proof of this, I don't know whether I have time to prove this today. Maybe I'll prove it because I just have 4 minutes. I think that's better. So let's sort of see that once we have proven this stability, this is really the crucial stability result that I wanted to get to. Once we've proven this stability result, let's note that this theorem of Gromov is a consequence. Yeah. Okay. So suppose you have some, so GS1 gamma, let's say it's a Cayley graph, so this is quasi-isometric to gamma GS2. Yeah? And I know that this guy is delta hyperbolic. What do I want to prove? I want to prove that gamma GS1 is delta prime hyperbolic for some delta prime. Well, you have your, so what does that mean? You have your, this is in gamma GS2. You have your points X, Y, and Z. This is in your second space, so this is called this X2. So this is in X2, D2. You know that these triangles here are delta thin. Yeah. Now, what do you want to prove? You want to prove that geodesics here in the domain space are also delta thin. So what do? You have your X prime, Y prime, Z prime here. You want to prove that the geodesic triangle between these guys is delta thin, right? So what are you going to do? You take the geodesic triangle here first. We don't know how thin it is or whether it is at all thin or not. Since the map is coarsely surjective, this is your F. You have your map F, and there exists X, well, coarsely equal to Fx prime, within some bounded distance, Fy prime, Z equal to Fz prime. Since F is coarsely surjective, you can choose X, Y, Z in your target space, so that X prime goes there, Y prime goes here, and Z prime goes here. Since F is a quasi-isometry, and we started off with geodesics in the domain space, these are going to give you quasi-geodesics in the image. Right? But This Morse lemma says that since the target space is delta hyperbolic for some delta, this F is a K epsilon quasi-isometry. So these quasi-geodesics are quasi-geodesics with uniform constants K epsilon. Therefore, this quasi-geodesic is within some less than equal to, this constant is some C, is equal to constant depending on K epsilon and delta, where this is the delta of X2. Right? So the quasi-geodesics here are going to lie within some distance C of the geodesics here. So this implies that this F Y prime F Z prime, and I'll draw this wiggle over it to indicate that it's a quasi-geodesic. This is contained in a 2 times, let's say 2, it's actually 2C plus delta, 2 times C plus delta neighborhood of F X prime F Y prime wiggle union F X prime F Z prime wiggle. See, what's going on here is that we know that this side is contained within the delta neighborhood of these two sides. Yeah? But geodesics track, quasi-geodesics track geodesics, so which means that this quasi-geodesic and this lie within some constant C neighborhood of each other. Yeah? So this geodesic lies in a C neighborhood of this. This guy lies in a C neighborhood of this. This guy lies in a C neighborhood of this. So that's going to give you this 2C constant. I think I put the 2 outside bracket just for safety. It's 2C plus delta. Yeah. So that means that you've managed to get thinness of this quasi-geodesic triangle in the target. Pull that back. So this implies, you just use this. This, what does this imply? This implies that Y prime, Z prime in the first geodesic space, this is contained in 2C plus delta times, say, let's say K plus epsilon to be safe. Because now you're going to pull back these quasi-geodesics, you're going to get that geodesic triangle. Neighborhood of X prime, Y prime union X prime. So basically, what are you going to get? Take any, what does this say? It says that take any point here. This is contained in this 2C plus delta neighborhood of these two guys. So suppose this is your nearest point on the union of these two. This distance is less than equal to this. When you pull it back, it's going to get multiplied by K at most and an epsilon added to it. So it should be here. So that distance multiplied by K and add an epsilon. So I'm being very cavalier with constants because finally the constants won't matter. Okay. So finally that will give us that the original triangle that we started off with is also delta thin. So behind this quasi-isometry invariance of quasi-geodesics, there is this Morse lemma, which I'll prove tomorrow.